Trevor, you're on mute, me. As I. Okay, bye.
Sorry. Bye. Good afternoon, kids. My name's Melissa Pienaar. You can call me Miss Pienaar or Miss Melissa. I'm very excited to teach Afrikaans Grade 8 FAL to you today. This will be our first lesson and we are going to learn quite a few things today. Hopefully something interesting. I'm not going to go through the whole paragraph there. However, what is very important is my email address, as you can see there, melissapienaar.atg@gmail.com. Please take a photo of the email or something like that, or just write it down so that if you have any questions that you want to ask me afterwards about the work, you're more than welcome to email me. If you are also a bit maybe not quite happy sorry, I'm just reading something here. Okay, so yeah, email me if there is anything that you would like to know with regards to the work. Okay, then today I want to say welcome, and then I would like to invite you, as I said, to email me if there's anything that you would like to know with regards to the work. And now officially I will be switching over to Afrikaans. Goed, ons eerste les van vandaag gaan so 'n bietjie oor iets basic gaan. Ons gaan begin met lees te gee en begripslees. Nou ek is seker daarvan dat julle al heel wat van hierdie in die verlede gedoen het, maar ek sê altyd mens moet begin by die basics in Afrikaans met enige taal, en dis gewoonlik klank leer of dan ons leesstrategie. So, ons gaan begin met wat beteken, hoekom is dit so belangrik dat ons moet lees? O, gats. Hoekom is dit belangrik dat ons moet lees? Dit is belangrik, want dit maak vir ons 'n nuwe wêreld oop. Hoe meer ons lees, hoe meer gaan ons weet. Dit spaar ons ook tyd wanneer ons lees, want ons leer iets nuut, en dan spaar tyd wanneer ons leesstrategieë gebruik. En ons leer wat die doel van 'n teks is en onderskei tussen verskillende tekste. In other words, when we read, we learn about the different types of text that we get, and also what the purpose of each of the texts are. For instance, a newspaper article, a courant article, will give specific information about something something that happened. Goed, ons begin met leesstrategieë en ons fokus vandag op twee. Die eerste een is vluglees en dan soeklees. So kom ons begin met vluglees. Nou, jy sal sien ek het daar 'n prentjie van wat ek ken as the flash. Nou, flash is mos vinnig, ietsie gebeur vinnig. En dit is hoekom ons sê vluglees is 'n vinnige proses. Jy gaan eerstens met vluglees die titel lees, en dan besluit jy waaroor jy dink die teks gaan. So if I give you a text to read, vluglees would be the technique you use there, is to literally go and scan through the text by you reading the title first, and then you decide what do you think the text is about. Wanneer ons vlug lees, kyk ons na hoe die teks lyk. Dit is gewoonlik 'n baie goeie tegniek om te gebruik wanneer jy koerantartikels lees, want ons fokus hier op die 5 W's. The 5 W's. Wie, wat, waar, wanneer en waarom. So when you read an article, it's very you can ask yourself what the 5 W's are. Die 5 W's. Wie is in die storie of wie is in die berig? Wat gebeur? Waar gebeur dit? Wanneer gebeur dit en hoekom gebeur dit? So dis vluglees. Goed, wanneer jy vluglees, kan jy ook die eerste en die laaste paragraaf van die artikel lees om so meer inligting te kry. When you vluglees, you read the first and the last paragraph to get an idea of what the article is about. And that's why I'm saying you're like flash when you vlug lees. You do it quickly and it's a quick way of getting information about the text. And after which you've done all of these, the first three techniques or first three steps, then you can read through the text in order to make sure that you understand it. The second reading strategy would be soek lees. Jy is op soek na spesifieke inligting. Met ander woorde, jy oë scan die teks. Wanneer ek soek lees, scan ek deur die teks. Ek kyk deur die teks. Ek soek spesifieke inligting, soos byvoorbeeld 'n naam, 'n plek. Daarso, jy is op soek na spesifieke inligting, soos datums, name, plekke ensovoort. Soek lees help dus om vinnig deur die teks te gaan vir die tipe inligting. So when I ask you in class, for instance, go and look, soek lees vir my die naam van iemand, dan gaan jy vinnig dit scan, soek na die inligting. Jou oë beweeg vinnig, want spesifieke inligting word gesoek. So, when you soek lees, it's a very fast process as well. You read, you read fast in order to get specific information. Right, ons gaan nou a teks lees, begrips lees, and then we're gonna look at the strategies and trying to answer a few questions about the text. Goed, wanneer ons 'n teks voor ons het, dan is dit baie belangrik dat ons eers pre-lees aktiwiteite doen. Pre-reading exercises. Right. Just want to see if there's anything there. Okay, so dis belangrik met pre-lees dat ons eers 'n paar goeters oor die teks leer. Soos byvoorbeeld, waaroor gaan jy teks? So as ek vir jou 'n teks gee of 'n boek gee, en jy kyk na die artikel byvoorbeeld, dan kan jy jouself vra waaroor gaan die teks. If I give you a newspaper article, you can look at the article and before reading it, you can ask yourself what do you think the text is about. So that is pre-reading activities. It's very important to know. Gebruik vlug lees as 'n tegniek en lees nou die eerste en laaste paragraaf en noem ook waaroor jy dink die teks gaan. So I'm going to give you the text quickly and we're going to vlug lees now. So quickly, look at the title, die wonderlike verhaal van Marco Polo, and then read quickly the first paragraph and the last paragraph and then ask yourself, what do you think the text is about? I'm going to give you about 5 or 3 minutes for that. Make it 2 minutes. Die wonderlike verhaal van Marco Polo. Read the first paragraph and the last paragraph to get an idea what the text is about. Okay, we're going to go on. You must have asked yourself now, what is the 5 W's? In other words, oor wie word gepraat in hierdie teks? En dit is Marco Polo. Waar gebeur dit? Hoofsaaklik in China en Venesia. Wanneer het dit gebeur? Met ander woorde, watter tyd het dit gebeur? Ons sien byvoorbeeld daar 1324, 25 jaar, maar in die heel eerste paragraaf 700 jaar gelede, dit is wanneer dit gebeur het. Ons het klaar wie, wat, waar, wanneer, hoekom het dit gebeur, waarom het dit gebeur, en jy sal sien later in die teks gaan dit duidelik word. So ouens, die 5 W's is wat ons onsself vra met, Goed, nou sê hulle vir ons, ons moet die 5, ons het nou klaar vlug lees gedoen, nou gaan ons soek lees. So ek gaan vir jou vra, gaan kyk vir my oor wie gaan die teks en in watter jaar is hy oorlede. Nou soek lees ons, so ons soek lees for specific information. So the information that I want you to go and follow now or look at is who is this article about? And we know it's about Marco Polo. And then I'm going to ask somebody specifically to tell me how old was he when he died. Let's see, Carly Bosoff, can you please tell me how old he was when he died?
70.
70, baie, baie goed. Thank you very much. Is it Carly?
Carly.
Kali, Kali, thank you so much. All right, so we're going to go on. Okay, so ons het nou gesoek lees en ons het gevlug lees daarso. Nou gaan ek gou vir julle verduidelik wat is die beste manier om 'n begripsleesteks te lees. Nou die eerste ding is, ons gaan lees eers die teks net vir fun. So stap 1, lees gou vir my, ek gaan jou letterlik net 3 tot 4 minute gee. Jy lees vir my die teks. Of weet jy wat, ek gaan ons sommer vir jou lees. Ons lees die teks rustig deur, net vir fun. Ons fokus nou op niks anders nie. I'm reading to you now. Die wonderlike verhaal van Marco Polo. Byna 700 jaar gelede is daar in die Italiaanse stad Venesië 'n seentjie gebore wat later baie beroemd sou word. Sy naam was Marco Polo. Marco se vader was 'n ryk koopman wat handel gedryf het met lande in Asië. Daar was destyds in Europa baie min bekend oor die lande in die ooste. Daarom het Marco Polo met groot belangstelling geluister na die verhale wat sy vader oor sy reise vertel het. Toe hy 17 jaar oud was, het hy sy vader en sy oom oor hoë berge en dorre woestyne op 'n reis na die ooste vergesel. Die reis wat 3 jaar geduur het, is met kamele afgelê. In die ooste is hulle vriendelik ontvang in die land waar Kublai Khan eers geheers het. Die huidige China. Al drie het by laasgenoemde in diens getree en om 17 jaar lang so goed gedien, dat die oosterse heerster hulle met kosbare geskenke oorlaai het. Hy het hulle ook by hulle vertrek tot in die Persiese golf laat neem. Marco Polo self kon die taal van Kublai Khan se mense vlot praat. Vanaf die Persiese golf het hulle oor land gereis na die Middellandse See en daarvandaan per skip na hulle geboortestad Venesië, wat hulle 25 jaar tevore verlaat het. Marco Polo is in 1324 op 70-jarige ouderdom oorlede, maar voor sy dood het hy al sy wederervaringe op skrif gestel. Hierdie boek word vandag nog gretig gelees. Goed, can I have an indication whether you've all read the text with me now? Is it possible? Just make a thumbs up or something like that if you've read the text with me. Alright, so ons eerste stap was, wanneer jy begripslees doen, om eers net die teks vir fun te lees. Ons lees hom net rustig deur. Dan is die tweede stap om die vraag van die teks te gaan lees. Nou ek gaan nie vir jou die hele al die vragies nou kan wys nie, want dan gaan jy al die antwoorde sien. So ek dink neem vir jouself hierdie stukkie af of hierdie slide af dat jy weet wanneer jy nou toets skryf of wanneer jy terug gaan by die skole toets gaan skryf of ooit weer 'n begripstoets lees, dan is hierdie die stappe wat jy moet volg. Eers gaan lees ons net die teks rustig deur. 2, ons gaan dan die vragies net deurlees. 3, gaan ons die teks lees en die antwoorde onderstreep. En 4, gaan ons nou die vrae sorgvuldig lees. Unfortunately, I won't be able to follow these exact steps today. You'll see my PowerPoint, I've got a question and answer, question answer. It's rather to understand the text. That's the doel van die teks van die les hierso. So please remember, there's 4 steps that you can follow in order to successfully answer a comprehension test. Firstly, you just read the text. Secondly, you read the questions of the text. Thirdly, you read the text and you start underlining or highlighting the answers of the questions. And then fourthly, you answer it very, very well. Okay, guys, just an important thing to note here. When you do a comprehension test, make sure you are very sure how many marks a question counts. For instance, as 'n vragie 2 punte tel, dan beteken dit jy moet minstens 2 goeters vir ons daar neerskryf. And if it counts 1 mark, you should make sure that it's a proper 1 mark answer. Did you know that when you write a comprehension test and the question states whether something should be yes or no and give a reason, if you only write yes or no, then you won't receive the mark. You should say yes and a reason or no and a reason. I hope you all understand that. And unfortunately, if the answer should be no, but your reason is correct, and the answer it should have been yes, then it won't count a mark. So make sure that the yes and the no really suits the reason. So make sure of that. And then again, just an emphasis, if you must look at the amount for each question, the mark allocated for the question. If it's 2 marks, 2 things. 3 marks, 3 things. Read your questions carefully. Just another tip. Take highlighters when you go to your exam. And when you do a comprehension test, use colors, lots and lots of colors, to break up the question for yourself. Say, for instance, a question asks what the text is about, do you agree, and give a reason. Then that's 3 stuff that ask in 1 question. What is it about? Do you agree, yes or no, and give a reason? That's typically an answer or question that counts about 3 marks. So please, guys, make sure that you are able to understand that. Right, let's go on. I would like you now, I'm going to give you 2 minutes. Quickly read through the text again, just to get your attention on the text of Marco Polo quickly again. Literally 2 minutes. In the meantime, if you've got any questions, please pop me a chat quickly so that I can answer you while the kids are reading the text. Another minute. Okay, I think that minute is over now. What I'm going to do now is I'd like a class whom participates with me. So ek hou daarvan as die kinders in die klas saam met my werk, want jy leer my dalk iets wat ek nog nie weet nie, of ek leer vir jou iets wat jy nog nie weet nie. I'm not the most clever person in this chat. We are all very clever and we can all work together. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read a question and I'm going to ask some of you to answer it for me. And sometimes I'll ask somebody to read the question for us. All right, guys. So let's start with Leah. Leah, please read the first question for us there, please. Leah? All right, let's go to Natalie. Natalie, please read the first question on the screen for us. Okay. All right. I'm going to read the question for us now. Oor wie gaan die teks? Is there anybody that would like to answer that question for us? Oor wie gaan die teks?
Hi Melissa, sodat ek in die rede val.
Nee, glad nie.
Moet ek hulle unmute, want hulle kan nie self nie. Dis gestel dat hulle nie kan self nie.
O, asseblief, ja. So, omdat ons 'n begripstoets doen, gaan ek so vra. Ek dink ons moet weer vir Lea kans gee. Ek wil graag hê sy moet vir ons die vraag lees.
Okay, ek probeer hulle unmute. Van hulle kan nie aan wie ek
dit okay.
Gaan met. Okay, bye. Okay.
Hallo Lea.
Ma'am.
How are you?
I'm fine, and you?
Good, thank you. Will you please read us the question that you see on the screen there, please?
Okay, ma'am. Oor wie gaan die teks?
Great. Would you like to give us the answer there? Oor wie gaan die teks? Yes.
Oor Marco Polo.
Oor Marco Polo. Thank you so much. Well done. If I had a sweetie now, I could have given you a sweetie, eh?
Thanks, ma'am.
All right. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to read us the next question. Waarom het hy so belang gestel in die ooste? Why was he so interested in the East? And let's give Natalie a chance there. Natalie, would you please go to the text and see whether you can find us that answer? Waarom het hy so belang gestel in die Ooste? Natalie?
Ek sien sy is een van haar wat nie kan unmute nie for some reason.
Okay, that's fine. Okay, Natalie, thank you. I just heard that you can't be unmuted. All right. Let's go to Khumolemo. I hope I pronounced that correctly. Can you tell us why Marco Polo was so interested in the East? Khumolemo.
Ja, ek weet nie wat gaan aan nie. Hy wil nie unmute nie.
Okay, geen probleem. Wat ek sal
probeer. Hulle kan maar in die chat net antwoord.
Okay. Okay guys, it's much easier if you would just answer me in the chat because some of you can't be unmuted and I don't want to waste a lot of time. So I'm going to ask and guys, please forgive me if I don't pronounce everything correctly. I'm really trying my best, but MK on Mikron, can you please answer question 2 for us in the chat, please. Waarom het hy so belang gestel in die Ooste? Kan iemand vir my daar sê, who can help him or her? Take your time. Mikron, let's see if you can answer question 2 for us. I'm going to give about another 10 seconds or so that we can go on to the next question. Okay, let's go on. I'm not sure if he heard me there, but question 2, waarom het hy so belang gestel in die Ooste? In daardie stadium was daar min inligting oor die Ooste beskikbaar en het Marco gevolglik baie in die Ooste belang gestel. Just to recap there, Marco Polo visited the East, China, those type of Eastern countries. And because there was not enough information or not quite that much information about the East. It's okay, Mikron, no, don't worry. I understand. All right, let's look at question number 3. In watter land is Venetië geleë? This is a very, very nice question. In which country is Venetië? Who would like to answer that? Let's go to Shire. Hopefully, Shire of Shay. Please forgive me. Can you tell me, Shire of Shay, Which country is Venetia in? Okay. I hope I pronounce this correctly. I say this in Italiaanse stad. Well done. Thank you so much. So it is located, Venetia is located in Italia, Italy. Thank you so much, Lucidi and Leah. All right, question four. Waarom? Verduidelik waarom die reise van die Polo gesin so goed bekend is. Guys, before we answer this question, look at the first word of question, oopsie, of question one. Verduidelik. That means that you're not only just going to write yes or no or whatever, you're actually going to give me a reason. Verduidelik. It's the same as when I ask a question, motiveer. Motiveer beteken, jy gaan moet verduidelik. You're going to have to give a proper explanation or reason. So verduidelik waarom die reise van die Polo gesin so goed bekend is. Why is their journeys, why was their journey so profound, or why was it so famous? And the answer there, Marco Polo het voor sy dood 'n boek oor sy reise na die ooste geskryf. Okay, so that's the answer. Marco Polo het voor sy dood 'n boek oor sy reise na die ooste geskryf. Right, I'm going to ask Tedeza. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. Ma'am, will you please read for us number 5? But yeah, please read us question number 5, please. Tedza, you could maybe answer the question for us. The question is, wat beteken dit om handel te drijf? Please don't worry if you don't understand this properly. Handel te drijf. Do you know what that perhaps means? Anyone? Question 5. Okay, guys, I'm going to quickly give the answer there because I saw, yes, Leah, well done. So it means to trade. Wat beteken het om handel te drijven? It means to trade. And the answer there will be die koop en verkoop van goedere of dienste. Now that's quite a high sort of definition of it, but in other words, it's literally the buying and selling of goods and services. All right, I'm going to go on. Wat denk jy beteken dorre? Let's quickly run back to the text before we answer that. Where, in which paragraph was that now? Dorre. Yeah, first line, third paragraph. Toe hy 17 jaar oud was, het hy sy vader en sy oom oor hoë berge en dorre woestyne op 'n reis na die ooste vergesel. What do you think dorre means? Anyone in the chat? What do you think dorre means? Take a chance. Don't worry. Take a chance. No, it's not toever. Not quite. Thank you, Lesedi. Anyone? What do you think dorre means? No, it's not towers either. Think about, I'm going to give you a hint. Is a desert a very comfortable place to be in? Is there lots of water? What do you think dorre means? Let's wait for one more. No, it's not a beach, my dear. Dorre means, it's not a paradise either. I wish it was. I wish it was. Okay, so dorre means something is very droog, nee. The woestyn is droog. That's a Mikron. Thank you so much. Please tell me if I don't pronounce your name correctly. Unmute me or something like that. Okay, so number 6, wat jy dink beteken dorre? Dit beteken droog, nee. Ietsie is verskriklik droog. A desert is dry. Number 7, waarom? This is a question that's going to ask you why you think something is like that. Waarom denk jy het hulle die reis oor land met kamele afgelê? Verduidelik. Guys, look at the question, how it's structured. They ask us why you think, and then you must explain your answer. So waarom denk jy, het hulle die reis oor land met kamele afgelê? Think for yourself, it's a desert, and they're using kamele. Why do you think? Anyone? Natalie, then there's a Helen, Leah, anyone? Camels carry heavy loads. Yes, that is a very good answer. Anyone else? That is a correct answer. Which other reason can they be? I'm waiting. Yes, thank you, Tseza. That's perfect. That's the correct answer. Okay, so they can carry heavy loads and they can stay long without water. So here is my answer. Hulle het lang afstande deur die woestyn afgelê en kamele aard goed in die omgewing. Kamele is 'n goeie en betroubare vervoermiddel in die woestyn. Yes, adapt to weather conditions. Thank you, Tseza. So there you have it, guys. They used camels because they could go long without water. They can adapt to weather conditions. They are the best transport that you can have in the woestyn. Good, able to walk on the soft sand as well. Great, let's move on. Thank you so much, Tseza, for your answer. You've done well. 8, hoe oud was hy toe hy uiteindelik weer in sy geboortestad aangekom het? Guys, this is a bit of mathematics. So, how old was he when he got back to his place of birth, which is Venetia, Italy? How old was he when he got back? I'm not going to pinpoint anybody here. Let's see who can answer me. Anyone? I've got a 25 and a 25. Great, let's see there. He was 42 years old, guys. Quickly do the math. Hoe oud was hy toe hy uiteindelik weer in sy geboortestad aangekom het? He was 17 years old when they left the city, and then 25 years later they went back. So that gives us 42. I say, thank you, Lesedi. Right, let's move on. Number 9, Marco Polo's reisjournale. Journale word nie meer vandag deur baie mense gelees nie. Is dit waar of vals? I'm just trying to get to the English word now. Reisjournale. Let me just quickly think on my feet here. It's journals of travel, so it's traveling journals. So they ask them, Marco Polo, so traveling journals, word nie meer vandag so baie gelees nie. Is dit waar of vals? En gee 'n rede vir jou antwoord. 2 marks. Waar of vals? En gee 'n rede vir jou antwoord. Is it true that Marco Polo se travel journeys is not being read so much anymore? True or false? And give a reason for your answer. Let's try in Afrikaans, please. Try, only try. Anyone? Come on, guys. Do you really, is it true or false? And give a reason for your answer. I'm going to give you about a minute or so. Okay, guys, I'm moving on. I would like you to look at the way the answer is structured. So they ask us, Marco Polo's reisjournale word nie meer vandag deur baie mense gelees nie. Is dit waar of vals? en gee rede vir jou antwoord. Dit is onwaar, met ander woorde vals. Hierdie boek word vandag nog gretig gelees. Guys, I see that I made a mistake. If I ask you waar of vals, then you can't write waar of onwaar. You must write waar of vals. Okay, so I made a mistake there. That should be false, not onwaar. Okay, so it's false. Hierdie boek word vandag nog gretig gelees. Remember, when you quote something from a text, you should always use aanhalingstekens. Remember that, please. And then you should copy it exactly as it is in the text. You can't, if you skip, then you must use ellipse. So please remember, use aanhalingstekens and copy exactly as it is from the text. You remember waar of vals, and then you give a reason. Guys, just one more thing. Interestingly enough, say for instance, the question or the answer to the question is waar, but your reason is not correctly, then you won't receive a mark. Say for instance, the question should be false, but your reason is correct, then it's going to be wrong again. So please make sure that your answers suit each other. Okay, I'm moving on. 10, wat kon Marco Polo doen aan die einde van sy reis? Guys, please, I'm going to give you a hint here. Go to paragraph 3 and then tell me what Marco Polo could do after he left, after he went back to Venetia. What could he do? Let's ask somebody here. Lesedi, can you maybe tell me? What was Marco Polo able to do? Wat kon hy doen aan die einde van sy reis? The answer is in paragraph 3. Lesedi, can you hear me? Quickly have a look there. What was Marco Polo able to do at the end of his journey? Can anybody maybe help Lesedi? Quickly put it in the chat box for us, please. Paragraph 3. Anyone? Yes, Kali, hy kon 'n ander taal praat. Yes, en watter taal kon hy praat? Kom ons kyk gou, ons moet spesifiek wees. Hy kon 'n ander taal praat. Yes, maar watter taal kon hy praat? Die taal van Kublai Khan. Yes, well done. Hy kon die taal van Kublai Khan vlot lees. Okay, next question then. Question 10 of 11, sorry. Hoe oud was Marco Polo toe hy in 1324 oorlede is? A little bit more mathematics. How old was he? And somebody gave the answer right at the beginning of the comprehension. Who can remember? Let's see. Yes, Kali, 70, because you gave us that answer. Well done. Okay, number 12. In watter land was die Kublai Khan se koninkryk geleë? Where was the kingdom of Kublai Khan? Anyone? Let's see. Let's see who's first. Kublai Khan, where was his kingdom situated? Das heißt, China, well done. You'll see there's two spellings of China, which is correctly. You can write it with a C or with an S. Okay, waaroor gaan Marco Polo se boek? Come on, guys. If you keep everything in mind that we've read about Marco Polo in this text, what is his book about? Please try and answer that for me in Afrikaans, please. Waaroor gaan Marco Polo se boek? Anyone? Okay, ek gaan adventure, that is a good answer. Maar what adventure? Wat 'n avontuur? I'm so proud of you guys for actually participating. It's very good. Mike, ja, dit gaan oor reis. Who can formulate a very nice answer here? Waaroor gaan Marco Polo se boek? Let's see, who can formulate an Afrikaans sentence here that gives the answer? Waaroor gaan sy boek? You can either give the answer to me privately or on the chat, doesn't matter. Oor sy reise, dankie Kali. And then just to be more specific, perfectly Kali, sy reise waar in die ooste. So I'm quickly going to give you the answer there. Hy het geskryf oor al sy reiservaringe in die ooste. That's it. Thank you, Mikon, Mike, Natalie and Kali for your participation in question 13. Okay, let's move on to the next slide. I hope everybody understood this question or the comprehension. Let's quickly run to my next question here. So guys, for me, when I do a comprehension test, it's also very important to actually do some language afterwards. So because you're grade 8 in high school, you're always going to have a comprehension test with a little bit of language based on that comprehension test. So, wat is die enkelvoud van seentjie? Enkelvoud means the simplest form of seentjie. Does anyone know? Just a bit of language. Just a, that's a, tsetsa, a seent. Thank you so much. Great. Maak 'n afleiding. Mense wat in Italië gebore is, word wat genoem? What do we call people that lives that live in Italy? But you must answer it in Afrikaans, né? Mense wat in Italië gebore is, word wat genoem? Don't mind the spelling. I'm going to have the spelling for you here. Italiane, almost there. Italien, almost there. Italians, ja, dit is die Engelse een. The answer is, so you've all tried very well. Thank you so much. It's Italianers. Italianers. Thank you, Tsetsa, Lea and Mikon. All right, the third question here. Feit of mening, is it a fact or is it your opinion? Daar was destyds in Europa baie min bekend oor die lande in die ooste. Think carefully. Daar was destyds in Europa baie min bekend oor die lande in die ooste. Is that a fact or an opinion? A feit of a mening? And I want a reason for your answer. Try. Let's see. Anyone? See, we've only got 2 minutes left, so let's make this one worthwhile. A fact or an opinion? Feit of a mening? Think carefully. Daar was destyds in Europa baie min bekend oor die lande in die ooste. Let's see. Another minute. Natalie, what do you think? Okay, Mikon says it's a fight. I'm going to shock you a bit now. It is actually a meaning. Because in that text, they don't give a specific date about when something is said. And it's also not scientifically bewys. So dis 'n mening, want daar's geen spesifieke datum gekoppel nie. So they didn't say, for instance, in Europa 1945, this was the situation. No, they only said they don't give a specific date, and it's also not scientifically proven. So that's then a mening, an opinion. Number 4, noem die leesteken in die woord Venetië. Look at Venetië. Do you see the E there? What is that leesteken called? Does anyone know? Okay, I'm giving the answer. It's called a deelteken. So the E there that's got a deelteken on. That's what my question was. I think this might be the last question. Wat is die homofoon van reis? Gee een sin vir die wat die betekenis duidelik maak. A homofoon. In other words, a word that sounds the same, but the spelling is different. What's the homophone? Who can quickly type me the answer there? Rice. Thank you, Tsetsa. Quickly give me a sentence with that rice. Let's choose Leah. What does that rice mean that you gave us there? I see there's literally a minute left. So I'm quickly going to give you the answer there. Magie vir ons testiek reis saam met Bredie. Okay, guys, I'm going to stop the lesson here for today. We will be continuing this last few questions on Monday, and then I'm starting something new with you on Monday. Okay, guys, thank you so much for participating in the class. You're a great bunch of kids. I really enjoyed it. And please remember, pop me an email if you struggle with any of the Afrikaans that we did today. That's what we're going to do on Monday. All right, guys. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful weekend. Take